cover this, shan't we?
Last video, I discussed the Mary Poppins books, so naturally, it's time we talk about the adaptation from Disney. Of course, discussion on the books is something I do still plan on bringing up. Truth told, I kind of felt that the books were hard to condense into a summary, so I will use the film's plot as a backdrop to talk about the books some more. This is ultimately, of course, about the movie, but the more I can inform on the books, cool. So I suppose the first thing we should probably go over is plot. And I do think this will probably take up the most time of the video, unfortunately, but it's just how it is. This is a movie that takes about 2 hours 10 minutes. The film opens with Bert doing his one-man band routine, entertaining various people who are hanging around Cherry Tree Lane, one of which is Mrs. Corey.
Mrs. Corey, a story for you. Your daughters were shorter than you, but they grew.
Somebody who I did fail to mention while I was talking about the books. She first appears in the first book, Mary Poppins, and is a recurring character from there out. Mrs. Corey is a local proprietor of a nearby bakery, and she actually has edible fingers. She just pulls off her fingers and feeds them to the baby twins. It's kind of weird, but it's what she does. And I did say I found Mary Poppins to be unlikable in the books, but I found Mrs. Corey to be a worse character. She is a straight-up bully to her two daughters who work with her at the store. One thing that she does do, however, is she affixes these paper stars to gingerbread that she sells, and what she does is she reclaims them and takes the paper stars and affixes them into the sky to make new stars. When we do see this in the book, she does get help from Mary Poppins, but it is established that Mrs. Corey has been doing this for a while. So I can see her doing it without Mary Poppins. Mary Poppins just gives a lending hand. But in the movie, really all that she's here for is a quick verse in Bert's opening song. While trying to come up with a verse for Miss Persimmon, a character I don't remember in the books, I kind of, if she was there, I just didn't take note of it. I didn't know to take note of it. She might have been there. Probably wasn't. Might have been. Anyways, he is trying to create a verse for her, but all of a sudden he noticed the wind changes directions, which means that Mary Poppins is incoming.
Dear Miss Persimmon, wind's in the east, mist coming in, like something is brewing, about to begin.
Gets distracted and finishes up the song, although to Miss Persimmon's annoyance, she is not mentioned, so she just totally leaves early. But eventually, he finishes and the crowd clears out. It's at that point that Bert addresses us, the audience.
Oh, it's you! Hello!
And it's with his help that we are able to find 17 at Cherry Tree Lane.
Number 17 Cherry Tree Lane, you say? Alright, come on with me.
And we are referenced once again by Bert, but never anybody else. So we're not part of the story. We're just watching the family. We're voyeurs. And this is actually familiar to something the policeman does in the book. If you want to find Cherry Tree Lane, all you have to do is ask the policeman at the crossroads. He will push his helmet slightly to one side, scratch his head thoughtfully, and then he will point his huge white-gloved finger and say, "First to your right, second to the left, sharp right again, and you're there. Good morning." And sure enough, if you follow his directions exactly, you will be there, right in the middle of Cherry Tree Lane, where the houses run one side, and the park runs down the other, and the cherry trees go dancing right down the middle. If you're looking for number 17, and it is more likely that you will be, for this book is about that particular house, you will very soon find it. When we do venture upon 17 Cherry Tree Lane, there's a bit of commotion going on there.
Storm signals are up at number 17. Bit of heavy weather brewing there.
Thank you, sir. Keep an eye skin.
As the children have gone missing for the fourth time this week, Katie Nana is leaving her post, trying to squeeze by before any of the parents come in. Slight difference from the book. It's not a, and I'm not trying to, you know, bring these up as a nitpick. Seriously, I just want to, I feel I could have done a better job talking about the books, so any opportunity to say anything about the books, I'm taking. In the books, she actually does leave before the parents realize it, although the reasoning is never actually given in the book. In the movie, however, she is stopped by Mrs. Banks, who includes her in the song Sister Suffragette. And I kind of feel like this might kind of be an anthem for the suffragettes. Not necessarily a personalized song for Mrs. Banks, although, I mean, it is the movie, so yes, it is, but we never see any other suffragettes, so I can't really prove it, but it does seem like she kind of sings this often, because when Ellen gets involved, she kind of has this look here that's like, oh boy, here we go again. And Sister Suffragette is an absolute banger, so it's a real shame that Katie Nana actually halts it before it finishes. It's also very unfortunate that this is the only song that Glynis Johns, I don't know if I pronounced her name right, I hope I did. This is the only song that Glynis Johns sings in the movie, unfortunately. Which is a dang shame, because she does a good job. Knowing her husband will be upset as the kids are missing and Katie Nana has left, she ditches her suffragette apparel as the cause infuriates him.
Going to be cross enough as it is to come home and find the children missing. Ellen, put these things away. You know how the cause infuriates Mr. Banks.
Yes, ma'am.
Also note, Mrs. Suffragette? Also side note, Mrs. Banks is not a suffragette in the novel. This is for the movie. Something that does seem odd to me, however, is that this is a Disney movie where the matriarch supports a group, an organization that often clashes with the police.
Take heart, for Mrs. Pankhurst has been clapped in irons again. No more the meek and mild subservient sweet.
And although there's no way that this was intentional, it's interesting to note that Mrs. Banks' sash here of the Votes for Women is the trans pride colors. This is made more interesting by the fact that the colors used in England at the time were actually purple, white, and green, the colors on the genderqueer flag. As Mr. Banks is arriving home, he runs across Admiral Boom, who is setting off cannons on his rooftop at 6 p.m. on the dot. Both Boom's pyrotechnics and punctuality are additions to the movie.
What he's famous for is punctuality. The old world takes its time from Greenwich, but Greenwich, they say, takes its time from Admiral Boom.
It's a bit of an odd addition, but it is appreciated as the family's physical comedy trying to get ready for the cannons going off is pretty good. It's fun.
Ghosts, everyone!
As Mr. Banks enters his home, he sings about how great it is to be a white man in colonial England and how great it is to be the head of his house.
It's grand to be an Englishman in 1910. King Edward's on the throne, it's the age of men. I'm the lord of my castle, the sovereign, the liege. I treat my subjects, servants, children, a wife, with a firm but gentle hand, noblesse oblige.
And here he kind of has one of those dumb dad personalities.
George, they're missing.
Splendid, splendid.
He doesn't realize that his children aren't in front of him exactly when he's expecting, but he eventually does realize the kids are missing. And then the constable bring them back. It turns out that they had run off because their kite had gained too much wind and they were trying to chase after it. Being frustrated with his kids running amok, he takes it upon himself to find a new nanny.
Choosing a nanny for the children is an important and delicate task. It requires insight, balanced judgment, and an ability to read character. Under the circumstances, I think it might be apropos to take it upon myself to select the next person.
And look at Mrs. Banks here. For some reason, she changed just to write what George is dictating. Also, I thought she wasn't going to be subservient anymore. Is that something that's just not going to happen?
No more the meek and mild subservience we...
Take this down, please.
Yes, of course, dear.
After he is done dictating his demands for a nanny, the kids come in with a letter of their own saying what they would like in their nanny. If I'm being honest, this is kind of like the one song I ended up not liking in this movie. So there's, I kind of want to just gloss over it. One thing to note though is that one of Michael's demands is that the nanny doesn't smell like barley water.
I never smell of barley water.
I put that in too.
Here's the thing, Michael. If you read the books, you know she smells like toast.
She always smells of toast. Do you remember? Her crisp apron is very crackly.
However, as Mr. Banks does not agree with their demands, he rips up the letter and throws it in the fireplace. The next morning, a pack of nannies... What would one call a group of nannies? is waiting to be interviewed, but Mary Poppins blows away the competition. Mr. Banks opens the negotiations, believing he has the upper hand, seeing as how Mary Poppins did not bring references, because she believes they're old-fashioned.
Oh, I make it a point never to give references. A very old-fashioned idea to my mind.
Is that so? We'll have to see about that then, won't we?
She does say that they're old-fashioned in the novel, but it's actually Mrs. Banks who is interviewing her there, and Mrs. Banks dismisses it because she doesn't want to be seen as uncool. Mary Poppins does get the upper hand soon here, though, because Mr. Banks becomes flabbergasted when he sees that Mary Poppins has the letter that the kids wrote. Being unable to focus, Mr. Banks inadvertently hires Mary Poppins.
What on earth are you doing? I thought you were interviewing nannies.
I was.
You mean you've selected one already?
Yes, it's done. It's all done.
Back in the nursery, the kids are getting acquainted with Mary Poppins, and she starts up with her magic. Not only that, but she shows her characteristic narcissism. One of the items that she takes out of the carpet bag is a large mirror in order to admire herself. In addition, she proclaims herself to be practically perfect in every way.
Mary Poppins, practically perfect in every way.
After cleaning up the nursery, she and the kids run across Bert, who that day is working as a screever, or a sidewalk artist.
Today, I'm a screever, and as you can see, a screever's an artist.
Despite the fact that Mary Poppins is generally uninterested in going into the paintings, Bert does trick her into transporting them into the paintings. Although, I don't know if he really tricked her. I don't think Mary Poppins is ever not in control. Once in the paintings, the kids disappear for a small while, and Bert and Mary go on a bit of a date. And while they're on this date, Bert is singing a song that just feeds into Mary Poppins' ego.
Oh, it's a jolly holiday with Mary. Mary makes your heart so light when the day is gray and ordinary. Mary makes the sun shine bright.
The jolly holiday sequence is based on the second chapter of the first book, The Day Out, in which Mary and Bert go on a date in his paintings. A few things to note is there's no penguins acting as server in the book. It's just a dude. And Bert's paintings are actually described as being lifelike. No, I wouldn't have nitpicked that, except Bert kinda is like, hey, I know it's not the greatest art.
Well, not Royal Academy, I suppose. Still, they're better than a finger in the eye, ain't they?
In addition, some other stuff that's added to the scene is the kids. They weren't in this chapter at all. And the horse race at the end. And as the horse race is added, Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious also isn't there. They do ride the horses, it's just not a race. Right after Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, though, begins to rain and washes the paintings away. And is it just me, or does Bert's vocalizations here kind of sound like Melanie Ravenwood in The Phantom Manor? Actually, hold on.
Welcome, curious friends. You may not believe it, but beauty once lived in this house. And beauty lives here still. Show yourself. Lovely, isn't she?
Once they arrive home, Mary Poppins gives the kids their geritol, uniquely flavored to each. In reality, I would have omitted that detail. However, the flavors here are actually pretty spot on to the books.
Lime cordial, delicious.
Strawberry,
Rum punch.
Pretty much. The only difference is that in the books, Michael has strawberry ice, not strawberry. Really not a big detail, but I threw it in. Ooh, and speaking of the books, Mary Poppins here practices her favorite activity. Gaslighting!
Really?
Mary Poppins, don't you remember? You won the horse race.
A respectable person like me in a horse race? How dare you suggest such a thing?
But I saw you do it.
Now, not another word or I shall have to summon a policeman. Is that clear?
And actually, something to note here is I think this Stay Awake song is the only song that the book Mary Poppins would actually sing. I could see her using the reverse psychology lullaby. I could see that. The next morning, a Mr. Banks, annoyed with the positivity of the house with Mary Poppins in it, sends the kids and Mary Poppins out to get the piano tuned.
One thing more.
Yes, dear?
I suggest you have this piano repaired. When I sit down to an instrument, I like to have it in tune.
But, George, you don't play.
Madam, that is entirely beside the point.
But before we find out that Mary Poppins' inner song is Pop Goes the Weasel, in the third book, Mary Poppins Opens the Door, Mary Poppins visits her cousin, Mr. Twiggly. The kids and Mary Poppins and him are all shrunk down. They stand on music boxes that reveal true song of their soul or whatever. Mary Poppins is Pop Goes the Weasel. She is brought to her uncle's after Andrew the dog tells her that he is in trouble. And here is a scene reminiscent to the books again, in which Mary Poppins' uncle has gone airborne from laughing. The difference here, though, is it seems that, well, Bert's here, that's one thing, but also it seems that Mary Poppins' uncle just becomes airborne when laughing. In the books, it's when he laughs on certain birthdays. Here, it just happens. After a song about laughing, and I actually do like some of this stuff in here, I don't know, it's kind of a... I kind of forget this song exists, but actually going back and listening to it, I do like it. Just Bert and Mary Poppins imitating the different laughs is... it's just a nice addition.
Some people laugh through their teeth, goodness sakes, hissing and fizzing like snakes. Not at all attractive to my way of thinking.
But after the song, Mary Poppins and the kids return home. When the children tell their father about their fantastical adventures with Mary Poppins, the father sets to fire Mary Poppins, as he doesn't like them being so imaginative.
I am disturbed to hear my children talking about popping in and out of chalk pavement pictures, consorting with racehorse persons, fox hunting. Yes, well, I don't mind that quite so much. At any rate, it's traditional.
Brilliant! It reminds me of the hunt!
But Mary Poppins, being the unstoppable force that she is, turns the conversation around and gets Mr. Banks to agree to take the kids to work the next day.
At my side, where are we going?
The bank, of course, exactly as you proposed.
Winifred, did I say that I was going to take the children to the bank?
It certainly sounded that way, dear.
Oh, just the medicine they need for all this slipshod, sugary female thinking they get around here all day long.
Before going to bed, she essentially tells the kids that their father is dense AF.
Sometimes a person we love, through no fault of his own, can't see past the end of his nose.
She tells of a woman who sells bird feed for tuppence a bag. Tuppence, for the record, is a two-penny piece.
Feed the birds tuppence a bag.
The bird woman is a character in the book, but, well, I just said it last time, so here I am last time. She also has a bit of a problem with the bird lady's birds, but that's probably because one of them steals a flower out of her hat. The whole bank run plot of the movie, that's not present here. In fact, the kids, it seems like, has fed the birds many times, and actually it was kind of like a, hey, you got to buy the bird feed last time, I want to buy it this time. The next day, the kids see the bird woman, and Michael wishes to purchase some bird feed with the tuppence that he has, but his father is forcing him to open an account with it.
I have tuppence from my money box.
Just this once, please.
Waste your money on a lot of ragamuffin birds? Certainly not. Michael! I will not permit you to throw your money away. When we get to the bank, I shall show you what may be done with your tuppence, and I think you'll find it extremely interesting.
The bank president, having heard the word tuppence,
tuppence,
comes out and sings a song trying to influence Michael to open an account by basically pitching the money's use in colonial pursuits.
You see, Michael, you'll be part of railways through Africa.
Exactly.
Dams across the Nile.
The ships, tell them about the ships.
Michael is taking too long for an answer, though, so the bank president, Mr. Dawes Sr., takes the tuppence out of his hand, and when Michael demands it back, the patrons at the bank believe that the bank is withholding money, and a bank run ensues.
There's something wrong. The bank won't give someone their money.
Well, I'm going to get mine. Come along.
During the commotion, the kids run into Bert and explain to him that they think their father doesn't love them.
A fine gentleman and he loves you.
I don't think so. You should have seen the look on his face.
Bert, of course, assures them that this isn't true and kind of has a speech that is kind of a little forgive your abusers almost.
You know, back in your part of, but the one my aunt goes out to is your father.
I mean, I wouldn't necessarily say Mr. Banks is, you know, the worst person ever. He's not the narcissist of this story, for example. But, yeah, it's there. But Bert decides to help take the kids home. Once there, Mrs. Banks misunderstands his reasonings for being there and puts him to work.
Well, I have to be moving along. The Lord Mayor's got to stop up chimney.
Chimney? How clever of you to know. Our drawing room chimney's in the most ghastly condition, smokes incessantly.
While he's working, Mary Poppins comes back from her day off, and, well, the kids get sucked up to the top of the buildings. There's a song, there's a dance. Plot really doesn't advance, so I'm just glossing over it. Eventually, however, a group of sweeps do enter the house, and, you know, there's a big song and dance still, until Mr. Banks comes in. Having just arrived home from the bank, he is then called to be fired. And here, Mr. Banks sings to Bert about how Mary Poppins has kind of ruined his life.
It's that woman, Mary Poppins.
My world was calm, well ordered. Then came this person with chaos in her wake.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Helen, it is now 8 o'clock.
And Bert, in response, pushes against his accusations of Mary Poppins and also uses some reverse psychology to challenge his home-work balance. Once back at the bank, Mr. Banks is indeed fired. After looking at some tuppence that had been given to him by his children, he has a change of heart and just lines up. In a moment of euphoria, he takes some stuff that his kids have told him, supercalifragilisticexpialidocious being a great thing to say when you have nothing to say, apparently, and a joke that they learned on their adventures with Mary Poppins. He lets out one of these jokes and leaves.
There are these two wonderful young people, Jane and Michael, and they meet one day on the street, and Jane says to Michael, I know a man with a wooden leg named Smith. And Michael says, really? What's the name of his other leg? There's no such thing as. It turns out, with due respect, when all is said and done, that there's no such thing as you.
There is no you. There is only me. There is no you. There is only me. There is no you. There is only me. There is no you. There is only me.
The bank president, after taking a moment to understand the joke, begins to laugh and starts floating. The next morning, having realized what in life matters to him, Mr. Banks fixes the children's kite and takes it flying with them. It's while there that they run into the other bankers who are also flying kites, and it actually turns out that, Mr. Dawes Sr. basically laughed himself to death. And seeing as there's an opening, they decide to give Mr. Banks his job back.
He left an opening for a new partner. Congratulations.
Seeing that her job is done, Mary Poppins leaves without saying goodbye. So, at the end of the day, how do I feel about Mary Poppins by Disney? I adore it. Considering my general distaste for the book series, I didn't have very high expectations going into the movie. But I loved it. And really, a lot of the issues that I had with the books are still in the movie. Mary Poppins does gaslight. She is a narcissist and... I believe Mary Poppins is always in control, so I think she planned for everything to go the way it did. So I think using the transitive property, Mary Poppins killed Mr. Dawes Sr. So with all that being said, why do I like the adaptation so much? Some may accuse me of being a Disney fangirl and... No, I do not see that. That does not sound accurate at all. But, you know, there is more to it than just that. First of all, the Sherman Brothers did a fabulous job with the score. These songs got stuck in my head, and it wasn't kind of one of those, just a spoonful of sugar helps. No, it wasn't, you know, an exasperated thing. I enjoyed having those songs stuck in my head. Again, didn't really like the kids' song about what they're looking for in a nanny. But they never sing again, so whatever. And Mary Poppins' less desirable traits here are played down, but also we are giving a character who is, well, just more negative than she is. Mr. Banks is a bigger jerk than she is. And by comparison, it makes her look better. Of course, one of the biggest reasons here is the cast, with maybe the exception of the kids. Just everyone, again, maybe not the kids, does a great job in this, but the real shout out has to go to Julie Andrews, which of course, you know, it's her role, that she is the title role. She gets lead billing, but this is the first movie that she acted in. And for the first movie to act in, to have to do green screen like that, she does a fantastic job. And she was almost unable to do this movie. She was trying for the role of Eliza Doolittle in My Fair Lady. a role that she originated on stage, but instead the producers went with Audrey Hepburn. Having an opening, she took the role for Mary Poppins. And in my Saving Mr. Banks video, I used a clip where Dick Van Dyke says that P.L. Travers didn't like him or Julie Andrews. There's actually plenty of evidence that she liked Julie Andrews. Julie Andrews and P.L. Travers actually had a correspondence of letters going back and forth. And P.L. Travers approved of Julie Andrews' casting, saying she sure has the nose for it. So, and this is kind of a side note, but she got a job for her then-husband Tony Walsh. He was the set and costume designer on the film. And while talking to the Sherman brothers, he kind of talked to them about Winnie the Pooh and what it meant to him as a kid. And at that point in time, the Sherman brothers still didn't know exactly what they were going to do with Winnie the Pooh and its music. Tony Walsh does a good job with the sets and really the costumes. Like, I love Mary Poppins' costume in the Jolly Holiday scene. Like, these boots. These boots are fantastic. Oh, and talking about sets, I should probably make a small aside. I meant to do this when talking the movie, but I kind of just skipped over the cleaning the nursery scene. But that scene was made in help with Exitancio. As a Disney Parks fan, this is... Well, this gives me a moment to nerd out, because Exitancio was the voice of the Jolly Roger and Pirates of the Caribbean, the ride. He wrote Grim Grinning Ghosts for the Haunted Mansion. And actually, in the Haunted Mansion scene, when you're going past and there's that coffin with a, "Let me out! Let me out!" That's actually Exitancio's voice there, which in the nursery scene, Michael is actually letting a, "Let me out! Let me out!" Interesting to note, this was 5 years before the Haunted Mansion opened. So I hadn't been excited for Mary Poppins Returns, but having rewatched the first film, I am actually very excited for the movie. And although the film is once again taking liberties, there are some stuff that is in Mary Poppins Comes Back that can be seen in the trailers. For example, Mary Poppins is brought down from the sky from a kite. There's the role of the park keeper, who in the book is the son of the bird woman. Probably not in the movie. Lennon goes airborne flying on balloons. And Meryl Streep plays Topsy Turvy, a character who in the books marries Mary Poppins' cousin Arthur Topsy, but it looks like Arthur's not going to be a character in Mary Poppins Returns, so it's just going to be Topsy Turvy by herself. One thing that is quite unfortunate, though, is that Disney seems to not be giving proper credit to Duncan Studio. All the 2D animation in Mary Poppins Returns was done by Duncan Studio, and Disney's being Disney. They're not giving them proper credit. I know that there's a lot of people hoping that Julie Andrews has a cameo role. Okay, I do hope that. But hey, at least we got Aquaman, right? But the cameo I actually want to happen is Glynis Johns. Again, I don't know if I pronounced her name right. It's been 20 years since her last film.
And when I say booga booga, you booga booga.
What's booga booga mean?
I don't know. But if I say it, you better fucking figure it out.
Now, I was originally going to do a video on Mary Poppins, the movie, last week, but I was feeling under the weather. I still am, actually, but I'm decent enough. But I'm actually glad it took me another week. Yes, Mary Poppins Month is going to be going into December now. I still don't think I'm going to do a recipe video. Maybe later. I'm going to say I do actually want to do it in the future still, but not in 2 weeks or whatever. But I am glad I took another week, because I was rewatching the film last week. I rewatched this film like 5 or 6 times while preparing for this video. Again, I actually really liked this movie. And I kind of realized something. Regardless of authorial intent, this movie is an allegory for masculinity. I mean, it just felt applicable to our current time. Now, I'm sure this topic is going to cause some people to turn away from the video, so, you know, whatever. If that's the case, bye. Those of you that stayed, you're cool. But allow me to explain. When we are introduced to Mr. Banks, he is singing a song that is basically how great it is to be a cishet white male in colonial England, and how great it is to be the head of the house.
It's grand to be an Englishman in 1910. King Edward's on the throne, it's the age of men. I'm the lord of my castle, the sovereign, the liege.
This demonstrates to us that he is used... that he is so comfortable with masculine roles and just the status quo that he sees no need to challenge anything because the system benefits him fine. I guess that, okay, white privilege also, I guess, has something in here, but I feel masculinity more so.
Consistent is the life I lead.
Upon first glance, it might seem that Mrs. Banks wouldn't really be okay with this, as, you know, she is a suffragette and is fighting for women's right to vote.
We're fighting for our rights, militantly.
But the reality is that she is subservient to her husband.
No more the meek and mild subservience we.
Take this down, please.
Yes, of course, dear.
And she doesn't want to push it with her cause if it upsets him.
It's going to be cross enough as it is to come home and find the children missing. Ellen, put these things away. You know how the cause infuriates Mr. Banks.
Yes, ma'am.
He does generally allow her control of the child rearing, at least before the start of the film. Being disappointed with her choice in nannies, he takes it upon himself to be in charge of at least hiring a nanny.
Choosing a nanny for the children is an important and delicate task. It requires insight, balanced judgment, and an ability to read character. Under the circumstances, I think it might be apropos to take it upon myself to select the next person.
Although, of course, it's really Mary Poppins who's in charge of the child rearing. Now, I'm not going to say he's toxic just because of his privilege, although yes, there is that, but just, there's a list of things. One of the few emotions that he shows is anger.
Ellen, stop making that offensive noise.
He spends no time with his kids, expecting them to be in bed right after he gets home.
603 and the heirs to my dominion are scrubbed and tubbed and adequately fed. And so I'll pat them on the head and send them off to bed.
Really, he just doesn't see... He doesn't see that it's the father's place to be in charge of the children's upbringing. And after Mary Poppins starts to influence his children and the whole house, he gets tired of the female influence.
Just the medicine they need for all this slipshod, sugary female thinking they get around here all day long.
And he tries to enforce his values and his ideas.
If they must go on outings, these outings ought to be fraught with purpose, yes, and practicality. They've got to learn the honest truth. Despite their youth, they must learn
about the life you lead.
Exactly.
Or at least he does on his son. Really, Jane's kind of along for the ride. I mean, it's Michael's tuppence. It was him that revolted. It's really his son. Once again, adding to the masculinity idea. The film does present us a yin to his yang, however, and it's not actually the titular character, but Bert. If Mr. Banks is toxic and hegemonic masculinity, then it's Bert who is non-toxic masculinity. If you ignore that whole forgive your abusers thing, let's ignore that. Bert is never angry. He's happy to help and is selfless. Instead of being devoted to money, he relies on the kindness of others and works several jobs. And he cares for beauty and art. He cares about imagination.
And it's all me own work from me own memory. Cheroo, I draws what I likes and I likes what I drew. No remuneration do I ask of you. But me cap would be glad of a copper or two. Me cap would be glad of a copper or two.
Oh, and, there's also this line.
You'd never think of pressing your advantage. Forbearance is the hallmark of your creed.
True.
A lady needn't fear when you are near. Your sweet gentility is crystal clear.
And it's not until these opposites meet that Mr. Banks really learns to appreciate his family. P.L. Travers was upset that the catalyst of the movie rests on Bert and not her main character. And yeah, that is unfortunate. It makes a woman's role lesser in her own story. But maybe Mary Poppins doesn't need the role? She already has a bigger one. Mary Poppins is a force. When the patriarchy tries to control her, she leads it by the nose. When I was talking about the books, I couldn't determine what Mary Poppins was. One of the conclusions that I could come to, though, was that she might be a mythological creature. I kind of like to believe that Mary Poppins, at least in Disney, is the embodiment of feminine strength. Okay, yeah, it might be a stretch, but I like it. It's a good endpoint. Again, I'm glad I took that extra week just to add that little bit at the end. But hey, that's just my thoughts on Mary Poppins the movie from Disney. There's actually another movie that was made in Russia during, you know, the USSR era. Maybe I'll try to see if I can find a copy of that someday. I'm making no promises. Don't even know if I want to. But who knows? That might be interesting to watch. But hey, thanks for joining everyone. This video actually, I am a little mixed on the results of it, but I am actually fairly happy with it. So thanks for watching. You know, take care, everyone. Remember that you are valid. Oh, and you know, maybe put in the comments whether or not you're excited for Mary Poppins Returns.
You find the fun and snap.
Start. I don't feel so good.
You're all right.
I don't know what's happening. I don't know. Hurry.
I don't want to go, sir, please. Please, I don't want to go.
The job's a game.